part will address mainly the design and the problems you're going to be faced in the selection. Then Tamer will take over and explain how it all is put together and the real part of the shopping work. First, we must understand what is the definition. Okay? What are we talking about? Shoring doesn't only involve having a hole. It also involves retaining ground above your head. Okay? It involves whether it is an excavation, nail, or depression. Okay? So, what are we talking about? Are you digging or are you filling? In both conditions, you have to consider shoring of some degree or another. Or do you really? Now, these are the sort of temporary types of shorings you have. Under temporary conditions, you have basements, or you've got embankments, or the like, which need to be temporarily restrained, be it below ground or above ground. Under permanent conditions, shoring or retaining walls are the same thing. Under marine areas or along embankments, it is the same principle of a shoring or a retaining wall. The only difference is that the design life of the structure is obviously different, hence the materials you select. Now, the question is, do we really need temporary shoring? I don't know how that came up. In the past, as you can see, they used to do open holes, and we still do open holes. If any of you have ever worked in Qatar, it's hard rock, so forget about any degree of shoring. You can go pretty deep vertically. So, the other question is, how else can you get away with it? Can you have open cut in the sense that you can have battered or stepped, or you can have combinations in which one side you've got an open butter and the other side you have a temporary shoring. Okay? Whether you select open cut or shoring is very much a function of the type of soil. If you've got a relatively stiff soil, i.e. we just classify as type 1, type A, you can have relatively steeper slopes. The more granular middle material will be what we call a type B, i.e. a 1-in-1 slope will be reasonably safe. Unfortunately for Dubai and Abu Dhabi, it's highly silty, hence you need to go flatter, 1.5 to 1. Now, as QSers, you all know that if you've got to excavate something which is 3 meters, and you're going to go in 1 and 1.5, the volume of the hole that you're digging, okay, gets pretty big. Is it justifiable to proceed with an open cut as against shoring? Okay? So, the things that we need to consider before we proceed are, do we have sufficient space to have open cut? You may have buildings or a road or some other structure adjacent to you. How deep do you really need to go? If all you're doing is 2 or 3 meters, then why waste your time? The other most important one is groundwater. You must remember that water, unlike soils, water, if it has a meter height, imposes a meter horizontal force. Whereas soil, a meter of soil, imposes 0.3 equivalent horizontal force. So, sometimes it is wise to eliminate the water from the design, from the principle, be it by dewatering or letting the water flow right through the temporary shoring. Okay? So as to reduce the forces that goes onto the temporary wall, which means you end up with a cheaper solution. Now, we have a question. Do we use temporary shoring, or we don't have any? Or we go somewhere in between? Before you proceed with any project, those questions must be answered. Let us assume that we have no option and we're going to proceed with some degree of shoring. But still, you have another question. What are we going to use? Is it going to be retaining? What are retaining cantilever? Do we need tie bars or props? Is it going to be a sheet pile or concrete solution? Or a combination, which is the king post? So, just selecting that you are going to go for shoring, that's the end of the story. So, we'll carry on. If we have no water, and it is going to be a temporary structure, you're going to either have salt deposits or contiguous, which means that they are open. They will allow anything to pass between them, but they will retain the soil. Okay? Those are the typical applications. If, on the other hand, you want a structure which is going to be watertight, you want a structure which has completely closed cells, Okay? That structure will have to retain water. Now, here's where all the complications come. Do you really need that? Or are you complicating the issue by retaining water? Can you take the water off from behind the retainment elevation? Typical examples of where you can have it is if it's within a creek, for example. Obviously, you don't want the creek to fall inside that piece and your works. Other examples, excavation near two basements. The last thing you want is adjacent structures interfering with your new works. Those are typical examples of what we mean by the principles of retaining walls, be it a cantilever or a cross brace. The two top ones are most common. Nevertheless, anchor in territory, even though it's a slightly more expensive solution, is quite often used in territory. The bottom one, the berm idea, it's used primarily when you have no choice. You cannot put anchors because there's maybe a building or maybe water on the land, on the retained side, okay, which will not allow you to install the anchors. And props, which has to hope not work. The only problem is, it may sound cheap, but when it gets to the constructability, option E is incredibly complicated, and you end up adding more cost into the building rather than onto the temporary works. Now, moving a little bit into structural design, there are all kinds of analysis that people can do, either manual or by computers. Nowadays, it's all done by computers. All kinds of softwares are available where you can produce all kinds of analysis, bending stresses, shear forces, loads, tensile capacities, and at the end of the day, you're going to end up with the information what is the loads that the member is going to be subjected to, how much will the tip of the wall move, and what are the secondary loads that are going to be applied, be it the surcharge or water in the front or behind. In simple terms, what you have is an active side and a passive side. You have a force on the active side, which is a function of the height retained and whatever force is above it, and the passive side, which is pushing in the opposite direction, and it's also a function of how much soil you're retaining. Okay? Now, as you see, there is an out of balance, and that is what the design in terms of bending. So the size of your member will be a function of how far those two forces are apart. What you should never do is, which are the function of the heights, but what you should never do is add extra loads on the retain, and start reducing the passive side. Because you're completely changing, and quite often you will see this happening outside. So, that is what happens when you do the make mistakes. Now, those are not projects carried out by DVD. This is another example of where a shoring goes completely wrong. This is where a QS has to be very careful. It may sound very cheap to you go along and have I-beams as horizontal props. But when the length of the I-beam, as you can see over here, needs to be reduced for whatever reason, or you start putting in things, loading the beam, so, okay, you change the properties and how it functions, and that's the end result. Now, this is another project which definitely has nothing to do with DVD. You have a flying prop, so all of a sudden you see a hole. All of a sudden, the collapse, even the collapse, and gradually it gets flooded, and eventually you have a soil. Some of you may know this particular joint, it's in the way. I definitely has nothing to do with DVD. So, the principles of design are, and it's very important for you must remember, no retaining wall can ever be designed without a soil investigation report. And without that, obviously, you're wasting your time. Someone has to agree what are the loads you're going to be applying. Why is it going to be adjacent to a road? Will there be labor accommodation? Will there be any other surcharges, be it on the retained side or on the excavated side? If there are obstructions, can you use a cantilever? Is it structurally adequate? Or do you need to put ties? If there's a basement next to your new work, obviously ties are out of the question. The materials. Most people will say, let's reuse as much as possible, chip piles. But is that the right approach? Driving chip piles will shake the whole ground. You might end up having ground settlement. The relative stiffness of the materials. Steel is a lot stiffer than concrete. Okay? But is it adequate for your particular application? All right. And of course, my favorite, regulations. Whatever design we come up with, we can prove it mathematically that it works, and then you have to deal with whoever is the relative authority. The municipality, whatever municipality, charge, RTA, Keys, TCOM, they all have completely different rules. For example, the M will say that the top of a temporary shoring, if it's adjacent to a sika or any kind of road, cannot defend more than 30 millimeters. Because you're going to give cracks to the road. If it's an open area, 50 mil. Trachis allow 75 mil. If you go to Abu Dhabi, the use of CFA piles, not very likely to be accepted. Okay? If you go to the end, in terms of reducing the pressure of water on a sheet pile, quite often what we do is, if we are retaining water on one side, we put a dewatering well on the retained side, so we drop the groundwater. It's perfectly logical, proven 1,000 times. The recent job we are now doing, the DM said no way. There's no logical reason why the use of dewatering cannot be used. That is just the bank. The price escalated by about 2.5 times. Yeah. Okay, so be very careful when you come to selecting which system of shoring is applied, because it's sometimes common sense is out the window. The regulatory bodies are the ones who rule over whatever decision or whatever system you can apply. So I won't waste any more time. I'll hand you over to Tamer, who will cover the construction aspects of shoring elements.
Thank you, Angelo. Take it from here. Now, continuing what we have, I'm not good in using this mouse as well. So, take it from there. As a QS, you need to know, in order to evaluate your rates, how we are building this retaining wall, and what's the equipment involved in the retaining wall as well. So, starting from the types that Angelo described, we're starting with soldier pipe, a cane post. As you see here, this cane post is normally used for shallow excavation, using beams and a pallet in between supporting the excavation, the retaining depth. The retaining depth here is varied between 5 meters to 8 meters. That's the maximum that I-beams can retain. Advantage of this system is very fast for installation. It's not taking too much space. Require this plant, as you see, require material storage, less storage area, easy in connection with steel struts and doors. Because when we are talking about 5 meter to 8 meter, this 5 meter, this is we can deliver. But to go for 8 meter, we require additional support, which is props, either props or anchors or whatever. So it will be easy for this system to do this struts normally. It's very easy because steel and by welding only we will attach the props to the system. The equipment used normally for this system is the vacuum hammer. We are driving the beams first using the vacuum hammer. This is the vacuum hammer and the back one single jaw. In some cases where we are facing very hard or hard air that's not penetrated using vacuum, we have used the CFA rigs in this case to pre-bore in advance in front of the vacuum. sure, this will increase the price as well. So that's why in some soil you will find the difference between the rates. You can say to me, okay, you have the same rate here in this project. It is whatever, 3,000, here is more by another 500, 600. That's why, depending on the soil, but in soil, some soil, okay, I'm using only the value of 100. So a lot of parameters like this, especially in the soil, strength of the soil is affecting the price of the value of hammer and the I-beam system. Going through quickly in sequence of work here, first thing we need to install the beams, we are positioning a guide beam. This beam is working as a guide hole for the beam to ensure the location of the beam. Then we start working with the bedroom, and you see here the photo, the bedroom is carrying the beam, start penetrating here. We are not using the drain, soil here was easy in this job. We are driving the beam down, and you see after this beam is filled, we are moving to another location, moving the beam again to another location with a certain space as per the design. So this is work as a guide for the beam. And at the same time, we are casting, this is the pre-cast panel. It's either to prepare on site or outside to bring. Here, the installation of the pre-cast panel. In this activity, we are starting excavation in front of soldier pipe and installing the pre-cast panel using either crane or excavator. Again, that depends on the site condition. This will be at the end. This will be the how it looks like. Then excavation to proceed. This is shallow excavation where you can see, as I said, around up to five meters in some cases, depending on soil parameters, we can go without support. And more than 5 meters, up to 8 meters, we are using anchors. In this one project where we are using anchors. Also, there's another thing we can use wood, which is not only precast panel. This is called very normal, sort of by with wooden planks. Sure, this is where there's no water. This is one of the advantages. You cannot use this where you have water. Also, in the municipality, in some cases, and for the building, when you need to do the service or to make the connection for the service to the building, we are doing some combination system. If either, if we are using it, can be used for the service. This will allow the services to be installed and for other authorities to install the services and make the connection to the building. Sheet pipe. Sheet pile is another system for retaining water. This is, can go up to 10 meters as a retaining depth. And sheet pile, the same, what is the famous type? We are using U type. This is the shape of the U type sheet pile and Z type. Or in some cases, we are using combination of the system as well. Either Z type and I mean, this is like combi type system. This is used to enhance the strength of the stiffness of the sheet, so it can go to more deeper. We can say the sheet pile and the soldier pile is almost the same advantage. Only the sheet pile is more for watertight. It is watertight system. This advantage is relatively weaker than shoring piles, not applicable in hard soil as well because of the vibration. In some cases, students who are using what we show now, vibro hammer, we are using hydraulic hammer if the soil is very hard, but also up to a certain limit. Same equipment used in sheet pipe the same like I-beams and soldier pipe. Even same sequence, but as you see in this photo, the same beams, guide the frame is there, and using the backhoe hammer to install the sheet pile, connecting one by one. This sheet pile here in this photo show as a cable next to water
This is another photo showing how we are doing the struts also in between the sheet pipe. It can be used for one of the couple of them. This is more deeper. And also, it is a good solution for piles where you have a limited space, like trenches for pipe laying and shops. This is now the other option for the retaining wall, which is contiguous pipe. Contiguous pipe, a lot of people they start confused. Contiguous pipe, we have no connection between the piles, as you see. Always we are keeping a gap between the piles. This gap around 5 centimeters normally, this is what we are using. And the depth here that contiguous pipe, we can go up to 10 to 12 meters. Again, the problem of this system is the water. Because of these gaps, we cannot say this is a watertight system. So it's also limited to the condition of the water level and the dewatering that you are running or composing in the site. Construction of this pipe is following the same sequence of normal pipes. We can say it's a normal pipe. We are either using the CFA method or normal drilling, conventional drilling using the casing, temporary casing. Or what we can say now is the more advanced method, which is recently in the market, maybe last from last 5 years, we call it cased CFA system. Cased CFA system. The difference is between cased CFA and CFA that we have a casing all over the length of the pipe. This enhances the quality of the pipes and also the verticality of the shore. Here we can, it can be used for hardware if we are using bigger machines for drilling. It's stiffer compared to sheet and secant belt, which will give more advantage to the designer to achieve the requirement of the regulation as Andrew just stated earlier. Here, instead of using the frame of the steel of the beams, we are using here fork to fork to do the guide wall. This concrete guide wall. The guide wall normally depth is around 60 centimeters. This is for the pipe we are using. This is very important to make the alignment and keep the block limit within control. We are not going out of the block limit. So this is very important for the showing. This is after completing the guide wall. Again, same method. This is drilling of one of the continuous pile continuous system using the CFA. As you see in the second photo here, we the rig is positioned in front on top of the guide wall. After that, we are shipping this sometimes and build the design. We require cabin beam or not require cabin beam. This is depend on the design and the depth that we are retaining. For the first photo, there is no cabin beam. Second photo, we have cabin beam for the contiguous pipe. You can see the gaps in between. This is another post showing anchor with support. This is for deeper excavation. Again, this is one for permanent application, permanent shoring. We said this can be used as temporary and permanent as well, in some cases. Here, secant pile. Secant pile, you can see this is, can go up to 12 meters, and in some cases, more than 12 meters as well. Structurally, secant pile can go up to 15 meters. But construction on site is difficult. If you go more than 12 meters, you will be under risk of having the pipe deviated, because here in secant pipe you have, we are working in male and female option. We call it female pipe, that's in the middle where you have soft pipe or soft pipe. We are using this concrete strength around 20 newton, 15 to 20. This done at the beginning, then we are forming by secondary pile, which is a steel reinforced pipe. Cutting between 10 cm to 15 cm, in some cases 20 cm, that's depend again on the depth that we are doing. If we are going more deeper, we need to increase the cutting in the pipe, because as we are going deeper, there is a limit for the tolerance, for the verticality. So machines is going 1 to 75, so this is the normal tolerance for the shoring. So if we are going 15 meters, there is a risk again to have the pipe out of tolerance and having gaps in the pipe. Once we have gaps in the pipe, that's again, this is a big risk in the watering, especially at the lower limits. In some cases, to make the stiffer, we are using also reinforced concrete, reinforced steel in the middle, in soft pile as well. In that case, it either will not be soft, it will be reinforced pile as well. And this sure make it more expensive. And you cannot find this system used commonly here, because cost-wise, once you reach here, you reach this proposal, this will be almost equal to the front wall option at price rates. So we will go to the front wall instead of going for concealment. Advantage of watertight system can be installed also in hard rock strata and is stiffer compared to sheet piles and soldier pipe. Here is advantage, additional cost of graniting, not the most recommended system for very deep excavation. That's more than 20, as I explained before, because of this issue. This is the same equipment we are using in CFA and in contiguous and the cement pipe. This is the normal method using temporary shoring. We have our normal rigs, drilling rigs. Or CFA rig, or this is what we are calling cased CFA drilling rig. In cased CFA, this make better control on the system of on verticality and quality of concrete as well for the pipe. Same sequences of secant hole is the same, similar to the contiguous pipe guide hole. Then drilling, here we are using the normal timber casing. And in the other photo, we are drilling using cased CFA. As you see, it is cased, fully cased. This is casing going full, so it prevents any contamination to the oil and give a very, very good cutting to the piles as well. So you have clear cut. Verticality also is much better than using normal rigs. After drilling, I guess you're going to be installed if you are using normal temporary casing. If we are using case CFA, we will have the concrete first pumped to the ground and then a steel cage, as you see in the photo, is installed inside the concrete using bagel. Again, after that, demolishing the guide hole. This is the, as you see from the photo here, this is the secant how it looks like in the beginning. You see there's no gaps like contiguous pipe, and this is very key. This is done actually by case CFA. In this photo, where we are breaking the pipe to the cutoff level to prepare it to receive the cabin beam, the steam from the cabin beam, you can see here, how is the water tight? You see the water at this side? This is the sea, actually. This is the seaside. We are here very close to the sea. Where you see in the other side, there's no water. It's clear. Then this is the cabin beams, instead of steel. This is four more for cabin beam. Again, this is some application from the secant pile. It's commonly used for shops. Here, deep excavation, you can see three layers of anchor. And also you can see how the verticality is shown here in the drawing. You can see the pile is not straight. Some piles look like this as you are going deeper. This is cut off top of one of the tunnel construction. As I said, once we reach a conclusion that we need a very stiff wall with the full steel and watertight, then option of the front wall is the best option. The front wall is like vice, but instead of having circular, we have it rectangular. Working with the same concept by secondary and primary panel. We have, but here all is steel, because this is the other, how it's working is allowing us to do all steel, allowing to do water joint as well to be installed during construction. This the front wall can range from 600 to 1,000, even 1,500 in thickness, and can go much deeper than binding. In some, the machines is doing the front wall can reach up 60 meter and more, which it is ready to use more than this depth here in the region. Through the front wall is the most quality and watertight system. Sure, it can be installed into hard rock strata, because the machine is more powerful, can go up to 70 MPa in some cases.
Much stiffer structure, and we can provide large concrete sections.
As I said, it
can go up to 1,500 thickness. The problem only on this system is the setup. Setup of the front wall is huge. Machine is huge to require plant, supporting plant to the machine. Require big area. So for small size, it is not recommended to be used. It's not possible to use. This is one of the systems of the, this is cutter using grab, which is different than this one. If you see this one, we call it hydromill. Here, the system, if this one you are drilling only by the grab, going down, cut the soil, go out again, throw the soil at beside the crane, she will take the material, go out. Here is different. This machine, and you can, by the way, you can see it. You have one machine working here, beside you directly. If you after them, you can have a look. This machine, we call this cutting wheel. It moves, cut the soil. This soil is pushed. Here, there's a bump. This bump pushing the material out from the hole. So it is very clean, more faster, and it can go more deeper. And controlling the verticality also better than the grab. This is what I mean by huge plant. This is the plant of the wall. This is the descender where the material coming from the cutter that I show. It's coming to the descender, starts grating the soil because we are using the bentonite, drilling under flowing. This bentonite coming on tanks and the soil coming out. This bentonite again bumped again to the cutter. So it is continuous operation. Here you can notice, as a for curious at this, this is the difference between that differentiate the rates. One of the very simple, this is the guide rule for the diaphragm, for the cutter. As you see, it's more deeper. Normally we are using 1 meter to 1.2 meter depth for the beam, for the guide rule. While in secant and contiguous, we use 60 only. And more steel as well here, more steel, more reinforcement. The reason of this, because the panels, if we return the back, drilling, as we said, this is the cutter. In drilling process, all this pipes, this is the supply in and out from the cutter. As we said, the hose, this hose is coming with the mud, bumping the mud to the descender, and this is the supply of contaminant to the hole. After that steel installation, concreting, shipping for cabin beam, having the cabin beam in place. This is custom cabin beam. This is one of the applications. This is with anchors. The advantage also in anchor in the foam wall, as we said, it's reduced. Because it is more stiffer, we can reduce the number of supporting props. In some cases, if we are using for the frame wall, for example, one row of anchor, maybe in secant we use two. Can be used also for deep shafts. This is deep. It can go up to 25 meter depth for excavation and more. Now, all these systems cannot work without the lateral support. So we have props, these struts or rakers, and the ground anchors. These ground anchors also either tie back or back-to-back tie rope anchors. We have struts and props. This struts is only, sometimes we are using either circular or beams, as the collapsed one that you show actually was beams, I think. Yeah, this is not the ultimate solution, not the best solution. If we have this long beam, the long struts, in that case we are using blanched column. This is to support the weight and avoid or reduce the buckling. Raker is the same, but it is inclined props, which is being supported to a beam or a bias. The advantage of this props and struts, that you don't need any NOC for neighbors. No NOC at all. And it is easier in installation, faster, cheaper also than anchor, because it can be reused again. After finishing, we just cut it and we can use it again. It's only that advantage here, and this is the fight we are having with all of the main contractor who is excavating after that. That's occupying a lot of area and make the excavation more difficult, and also the construction as well after. But in some cases, there is no other solution. As you see, this is struts. Somehow we are using corner struts or struts. This is a form of the underpass tunnel. This is for trenches, also for pipes is used. This is the rakers where it's supported to a pipe at the end, where, as you see, the irregular shape of the strut, because of the location of the pipes, we need to consider not affecting the raft or other issues. So we are locating it in a way not affecting the raft. As you see, also this is all some types of struts. Then ground anchors. This is also the other system that provide the lateral support. Anchors is, as you see, anchors are coming. It's consists of fixed length, free length, and anchor head. This is what we are calling. We are using a strand. This strand we are grouting on the soil. After installation of the strands to a certain length, as per the design and as per the soil condition, and we have to keep a free length like that for tension to stress the anchor. This is the machine used for anchors. In several, can be used again, as I said, in all systems. Then after installation, this is how we are stressing, using the jacks to stress the anchor and apply the load, the required load. Should the advantage of anchor that you have a clear space for excavation. no obstruction at all. You just do the anchor, stress it, lock it, and excavate. And it can be used also as a permanent solution. It's not only temporary, which is not common to use the anchor in as a permanent solution. But in some cases, it is used as a permanent. It can last for 50 years under certain conditions and other certain methods of construction. From the disadvantage in OC is if you have existing structure, it's taking more time. Again, it's the struts because you need to have to wait for curing and stressing and locking off the anchor. Anchor drilled using the anchor drilling rigs. This is the strand installation, then stressing using the stressing jacks, then doing the locking of the anchor. As you see here, this now the anchor is ready to carry the load. This is here you can see in the secant wall. This is also. This is the back-to-back anchors. This is normally used in sheet piles. This is the common use for it in sheet piles.
Thank you very much, Mr. Angelo, Mr. Tamer, for giving us some valuable insights on various retaining wall tiles and some of the authorities' regulations, as well as some design aspects. And we got a very good informative seminars today. Thank you very much for this. If you have any questions regarding today's topic or any other technical queries regarding piling or retaining wall, you may ask, please.
I have one question.
Yes.
It is regarding bentonite.
Yes.
What is the role? Why is it used bentonite? What is
it used?
We are using bentonite when you have a soft soil, sand soil. You have sand soil, we are using bentonite. Okay, or polymer in some cases. This is working as a support flow, supporting for the shaft not to collapse. Okay, if we have a rock strata, normally this is what we are preferring. To have a rock, we are penetrating the temporary casing with whatever length. If it's possible to do, we can do up to 16 meter casing. If we have a rock up to 16 meter, we just penetrate the casing through all the soft layer till it's going inside the rock for at least 1 meter, 1.5 meter, then we to avoid any collapse. But if we cannot do this, if this rock is 20 meter, for example, below, we cannot go for temporary casing. So in this case, we to support this soft soil or sand silt, we are using this support as a support for that plant or polymer.
In terms of cost effective
bentonite
piling,
what is
the advantage? Which one is cost effective? Is it compared to second pile and condiges? Condiges one is expensive.
The most expensive one is
the diaphragmal system, which also the most clean system, the most quality-wise system is the diaphragmal. Coming after that, the secant. This is as the same as I stated there. This is the cheaper, going to the more expensive. So we have the cheapest, the soldier pile, coming to the cheap pile, contiguous pile, and secant, and the diaphragm wall. Again, this is depend on soil. You cannot see. I cannot give a range. Okay, maybe this is the, we can say contiguous pile is more expensive by 15%, 5 to 15% than sheet pile or than soldier pile. But this only depends on the soil and how the design, the steel you are using, the thickness of the wall. This is a lot of parameter there. The method of construction, as I explained in one of if you are using, for example, for the vibro, I'm using vibro only, or I'm using also another rig to penetrate the heartbeat. So all these things is affecting the rates of the system. I show you here also this small thing that make a difference between the rates, because I'm getting this question: why your price in this project is different than this project, and it's in the same system? Okay, so I'm using here soldier pile with this rate, and the same soldier pile here is more. Why? And the same retaining depth. Some people say, okay, the same retaining depth also. So why is here and okay? A lot, again, either maybe in this soil I use bigger section of the beams. It's soldier pile, but it's bigger section because of the soil. Or I need to use the CFV rigs or to do pre-drilling in front of it, because the soil is very hard. I cannot penetrate only with vibro. So that's why rates are different. Even for the same system, we cannot say this is a fixed rate.
Contiguous or second pile, you said there is always a risk of deflection. So in case the deflection happens, how to overcome that? How to overcome that risk?
Okay, deflection unfortunately can be seen in many different ways. It can be the deflection on the top of the pile, or to be the deflection like a bulge, like me. Okay? Now, what you need to consider is, what is the criteria? I.e., are you building a retaining wall just adjacent to a road? Or next to a water main? Okay? Obviously, you want to constrain the top deflection. If it happens to be next to a water tank, which is deep, an underground water tank, you want to constrain the bulging deflection. If you are in the middle of, not a desert, but where there's no obstructions, what's the point of restraining the deflection? Okay? This comes into the type of material you want. If you've got a structure where you want, where you know it's possible to extract the temporary wall, i.e. sheet piles, okay, and you have no issue with how much deflection it can take, okay, structurally it will hold. It may deflect by half a meter, but it's not going to collapse. Okay, but then you've got our famous municipalities and truckies and all the other authorities. Some of them obviously take into consideration not just what's around them, as I said, the sub-cutter road, the water tank, or whatever. It's also the field comfort effect. If someone sees something flexing like this, they'll say, oh, it's going to collapse. It's the lack of understanding, okay, of those who, with little knowledge, try to advise, you know, the owners. And that's where deflection comes into the play. You can control deflection by having a stiffer section, introducing anchors, okay? Installing the member, as sometimes we do it, in reverse of the actual position. Hence, it will deflect and it will become vertical. Okay. So deflection, unfortunately, it's not the fundamental structural design criteria, because it can deflect and it will not fall down, but it is a secondary criteria imposed primarily by authorities and by the feel-good comfort. How much deflection? 25 millimeters? 100 millimeters? That'll work. If you have, for example, quite often they say you see concrete and it can't deflect much because it will crack. Yeah, so what? It's temporary. If you have, a number of structures that I've done, I put the reinforcement on the surface, zero cover. Oh, it's wrong, it's going to corrode. So what? Unlike other jobs that we are also involved with, that were built in 2006, 2007, 2008, the client ran out of money, filled the hole, and now we've been called back to excavate the hole and reuse the same temporary works. Now guys, you design a structure with a design life of whatever its construction is going to be. Tell us if you want a structure with a six-month life, you know, to go down, excavate, build your basement, we'll give you that structure. Okay? But don't expect that thing to still perform later on. Thank you.